I appreciate it.
Okay. So it's off right now. It's off right now, right?
Thank you.
Thank you, choir. I can't believe it's the last time we're going to hear that song. I'm sure they'll do a remix. Digital remix, choir remix. Good morning, everyone. Feels like a little mellow day. That good morning was very mellow. I can feel it. I can feel it. Welcome, those of you coming in. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to Emerson Unitarian Universalist Congregation. My name is Reverend Deborah Bennett, and it's a delight, as always, to be the called minister here, and I welcome you. It's really good to see you. I just feel like it's really good to have this place, and I really honor that you each choose to come here on Sunday mornings. We come here to do the joyous and sometimes challenging work of building community. And I know we each come here for different reasons on different Sundays, but ultimately what we do together is build this community. And I want to invite you to just take a moment and look around. And these are people that you are choosing to build community with. And I welcome you. I want to especially welcome those that are joining us online, building community online. Hello, online folks. I know a few of you are coming, joining us from very close by, and there's some folks that join us from quite a distance away. And we just really want to make sure you know we welcome you, and you are glad you are part of this community as well. Special welcome to anybody online or in person that's joining us for the first time. We are a Unitarian Universalist congregation, so we really want you to know that you are welcome here. Whoever you are, wherever you call home, whomever you love, you are indeed welcome here in your full selves, and we hope that you're nourished in heart and mind with your time here with us this morning. This morning, we are going to conclude a month-long focus. We tend to hold a theme for a month, and our theme this month has been service. Service is our prayer. And today, we're going to do a little reflection time and reflect on those inner forces at play that may stand in our way of being of service and talk a little bit about how to overcome those forces. Our service today is titled, Filled with Loving Kindness. And indeed, that is going to be our attempt today, to fill ourselves and each other with love and kindness. Most of you may know that today begins the high holidays in the Jewish tradition. It is Rosh Hashanah. Rosh Hashanah begins tonight, and it celebrates the beginning of the new year in the Hebrew calendar. It ushers in 10 days of awe that will follow. We're going to talk a little bit more about that and Yom Kippur a little later in this service. But I want to begin this morning with a piece that's relative to both our idea of service and the idea of a new beginning or a new year. This is a piece by Marge Piercy, and it's called The Birthday of the World. On the birthday of the world, I begin to contemplate what I have done and left undone. But this year, not so much rebuilding of my perennially damaged psyche, shoring up eroding friendships, digging out old stumps of old resentments that refuse to rot on their own. No, this year I want to call myself to task for what I have done and not done for peace. How much have I dared in opposition? How much have I put on the line for freedom, for mine and for others? As these freedoms are pared, sliced, and diced, where have I spoken out? Who have I tried to move in this holy season? In this holy season, I stand self-convicted of sloth in a time when lies choke the mind and rhetoric bends reason to slithering, choked pythons. Here I stand before the gates opening, the fire dazzling my eyes, and as I approach what judges me, I judge myself. Give me weapons of minute destruction. Let my words turn into sparks. The birthday of the world. So today we're going to take a moment to look and reflect on our own lives this year, and we're going to turn to some wisdom from loving kindness on how to embrace how we move forward. Sound like a good plan for the morning? Yeah, let's sing. Shall we sing? Singing is always a good way to start. The words are on our screen, I believe. Maggie will be putting those up there. If you would like a hymnal, they are 346. That's in the gray hymnal. Come sing a song with me. It's a wonderful way to start today. Let's sing together.
Melanie LeMay, she said I should use my school bus driver voice this morning. So that's what I'm doing. My name is Ed Cosper. I'm a member of the worship team, and I sing in the choir, and I do a few other things around the building and whatever I can do to help out this community. I extend my welcome to each of you today, and I'm so glad you are here. Each Sunday, we pause to light our chalice as a symbol of Unitarian Universalism and our commitment to be a beacon of love in the world. This morning, senior youth Adrian Tice will light our chalice.
This morning's chalice lighting words are from Richard S. Gilbert. May the oil of loving kindness flow from us to thy leaping flame. May the hands of service shelter thee, that no winds of hate may extinguish thy brightness. May thy light and warmth be eternal. May we be keepers of thy flame.
Thank you, Adrian. Boy, Adrian's voice is getting down there, too. All right. Now, in the spirit of the beloved community, let's greet and welcome each other to this new day as we share our congregational affirmation. We need not think alike to love alike. Now, those in the sanctuary, please feel free to move around to offer a greeting to others. For those online, please use the chat to introduce yourself or unmute to say hello. But let's get busy saying hi.
Thank you. Good morning. My name is Ginger White, and I serve as a member of our Emerson Pastoral Care Team. At this time in our service, we pause to reflect on and share the joys, sorrows, and concerns of our lives, and light candles of our shared care. Prior to the service, we light these three candles that hold our collective sorrows and hope. These candles recognize the collective pain and suffering of the Cherokee and Muskogee nations of people who lived on this land before us. The Africans who were brought to this land and enslaved, and the pain and suffering in all nations of people where there is conflict and injustice. Before our service each week, we are invited to add to this care table, lighting a candle for anyone you are holding in your heart. Many of these lights humbly remind us of our interconnection and the impact of our collective actions. May they be the light of hope and the peace among all people. We now turn to our personal joys and sorrows and concerns. You are invited to write a note in our care book prior to service. It is located at the entrance of the sanctuary, or you may email us at pastoralcare@emersonuu.org. We have several joys. Michael Lukens and Douglas Fuch, is that? A joy, Michael and Douglas are celebrating the success of Michael's back surgery on Tuesday and are grateful for all of the well wishes and healing energy sent to them. They would like to ask for the continued energy as Michael works towards full recovery. And this is from Elizabeth and Clark Thomas. Super happy for Theodore to reach the ripe old age of 16 yesterday. And from Laura, that we don't have a morality police here is a joy. That there is such a group is a sorrow. And with an open heart, let us hold these sorrows and concerns. We have a concern from Gail Passo, who is currently in the hospital, and she would enjoy phone calls, texts, emails, or cards. We know there may be joys, sorrows, or concerns not spoken. And as Reverend Deborah lights our candles, please feel free to say out loud or type into the chat the name of someone you are holding in your heart today. Darla. Please join me in a moment of silence as we allow ourselves to feel part of this community of care. Let us send our heartfelt, caring intentions to each other and to all beings everywhere by offering the Buddhist prayer of loving kindness as we repeat it together. May we all be filled with loving kindness. May we all be free from harm and suffering. May we all be well in body, heart, and mind. May we all be at peace. Blessed be.
One way we seek to share loving kindness is by partnering with other organizations who work to bring love, kindness, and justice to the world. Today is our final Sunday to partner with the Cobb County Center for Democracy. The Center for Democracy is part of the national organization, the Center for Common Ground. The center was founded to educate and empower underrepresented voters in voter suppression states to engage in elections and advocate for their right to vote. The Democracy Center provides peer-to-peer voter services and education, including courses on civics and effective citizen lobbying. Plus, they work to provide opportunities for participation within the political process at the local, state, and federal levels. We encourage each of you to support this vital work financially through our Share the Basket program and also by engaging in direct action. Please offer a donation as you are able, or take one of the cards that describes the ways we give electronically. Ways to give are also posted on the chat. And all donations, unless otherwise specified, are shared equally with Emerson and our partner organization.
Hey there. Will the young and the young at heart please join me up here for the story for all ages? Yeah? Come on, don't be shy. So we got some props today. Actually, they just helped calm me down. There you go. So today we're going to hear a story about some old school G units, which in our case means grandparents. Okay, so in old Japan, which is a lot like New Japan, just older, there was a grandma and grandpa who lived alone. And yet they had their fun, they'd sing, they'd dance, they'd, you know, they like to use fancy new words like 23 skidoo, right? You guys know that one? Well, this is hundreds of years ago, so they're ahead of their time, okay? You know, where things are fly, funky fresh, that kind of thing. And how they made their living is they would weave baskets, right? Weave baskets, and they'd also weave sandals. So they got a big batch of these ready, tons of sandals to go, you know, shoe many feet, tons of bags to, I guess, carry stuff, right?
Carry the shoes.
There you go. Yeah. And Grandma sent Grandpa out because it was New Year's, and there's a New Year's tradition. Do you guys have New Year's traditions? Something special you do? Fall asleep, fireworks?
Fondue.
You eat fondue? There you go. Yeah, some people, they shoot off fireworks, you know, they drink sparkling grape juice or, you know, whatever, right? But in old Japan, what they do is they would make mochi, right? And mochi, or you have to use rice flour to make it. So they wanted to go get some rice, and they said, we're going to sell so many bags and so many sandals, we're going to make so much rice, this is going to be off the chain, okay? So Grandpa goes, and he's walking along, and he stops, and he sees some statues. These are Jizo statues, right? They don't really look like this. These are a lot cuter. But the real ones are pretty cute, too. They're just made of stone. And what they do is they protect people, right? They protect them from evil spirits. And travelers will come by, and they'll stack a stone or things like that. And if you visit one of these locations, they actually have stones that are stacked really, really high, just over hundreds of years from people doing that. Which is a good thing, because the stones fall, that means that the magic is broken, evil spirits can attack, and that's when the Jizo statues come to life, and they have to go fight them off. Wah, 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 right? I don't know if they make quite that noise, but that's what I imagine. I haven't seen them in action. So Grandpa saw him, and he saw that, you know, it's starting to snow. He's like, ah, well, I better hurry up to town, right? So he hurries to town. He starts selling all the stuff. He sells almost all of his bags, all the shoes, and he's got quite a bit of change, okay? He's a ballin', as they used to say in old Japan. And all he can think about, though, is those statues. He's like, they're going to be cold, which may sound crazy, but, you know, in the Shinto tradition, it's not, right? All things have spirits, all things are alive, right? So he decides, you know what's the good thing to do? He goes and he buys a bunch of hats. And he goes and he walks back to where the statues are, and he decides that the smart thing to do is to give them hats, right? I think they'll look adorable with them, right? So each of them gets a hat. You get a hat, you get a hat, you get a hat. And Grandpa goes and he admires his work, and he realizes that he's made a mistake, because there are not five statues, there are six. So he takes the wonderful custom hat that he has made himself and puts it on the little tiny Jesus statue, right? So all of them, you know what, they won't get cold in the snow, because if they're cold, they can't do their job, right? They got an important job. And he walks home, and he's like, Grandma might be a little bit upset, right? So he goes and he tells her, and she's just very, very quiet, which is much scarier than when someone gets mad, right? And she goes, and she says, "Daijoubu da yo." You know what that means?
No.
Okay, well, just to kind of translate it, it just means, don't even trip, boo. And he goes, "Honto?" Like, really? For serious? And she goes, "Hai." Which is like, it's hai. So Grandma's cool with it. So they said instead, they're just going to pretend they have rice, and they're going to go take the flour, and they're just going to pound it, which is pretty fun, right? They sing their songs, you know, ain't nothing but a G thing, baby, two grandparents just pounding rice, right? I made that up myself. So that night, it's getting to be around midnight, and they hear, and they go, what the heck is this there? They're like, the grandchildren come to visit? No. Instead, they look out, and you know what they see? Boonk, boonk. What's jumping down the lane? What do you think?
The statues.
The statues, right? And Grandpa's like, man, good thing I took care of them. Like, they're really alive. That would be bad, right? So they all go and they jump up, and they're singing their own song, right? They're thinking, up on the hill, we're visiting Grandpa, he gave us hats. And that's not a great song, but these things are made of stone. Like, the fact that they can move and sing at all, let alone make a song, is a big deal. Okay, so keep that in mind, okay? Be generous. So they go and they leave a treasure for them, which in their case is just, it's a bag full of rice that's enough rice to last them the rest of their lives, which they're kind of old, so it's about this bag full. It's not sad, it's good. They'll be happy as long as they live. So anyway, that's the story. Hopefully you've learned something from it, okay? So if you want to join me for the song of dedication, let's stand up.
Needs any pastoral care after that story, come see me. Yep, that just happened. All right. Boy, I think I'm supposed to say something that's not on one of these pieces of paper. Hold that thought. All right, here we go. All right, well, this morning we're going to, instead of doing our time of centering in this time, we're going to do that a little later. We're going to take a moment to take some time to honor the service of several people in the congregation. In 2020, Emerson moved to a new governance structure. Some of you may or may not be familiar with that. It's a leadership model whereby, in addition to the board of trustees, we also now have what we call ministry associates. And the ministry associates are trained volunteer leaders who assist the minister in visioning, planning, coordinating, and supporting all the shared ministries of the congregation. These areas of what we call program ministries include worship, and music and justice, religious exploration for adults, spiritual practice, our listening circle ministry, and hospitality and fellowship groups. So together, that group of people with the choir director, Kathy Middleman, and music coordinator Bruce King, Beth Klein, who's the family ministry director, and myself, we form what we call a ministry council. So we get together and we do a lot of work in looking at how can we move forward the ministries and support the committee chairs and all the work that happens here. So the members who take on these roles as ministry associates are people who hold a deep commitment at Emerson to Unitarian Universalism and to the community in general. And they also commit to deepen their own spiritual practices, their own congregational knowledge through training and just through general commitment of showing up over and over again. So I would like to officially install these three into these roles. Even though we started these roles a couple years ago, we never had an official installation. So now is our time to do that. So I'm going to invite Millie Fuller and Ed Cosper and Mark Cobb to join me up here. Dun, dun, dun. We should have some walking music. That's okay. There we go. Happy walking music. This is a happy time. My three dears, today we formally install you into the role of ministry associate. This is a role that you have helped create and have held for some time now. Millie and Ed, you joined this team back when we were just starting in 2020, the spring of 2020. And Mark, we were pleased that you joined us last year and served for all of last year. Together, you have offered many, many hours of service and study in this role, and you have truly blessed my ministry. It could not be what it is without each of you, and I really hope you know that. And you work in so many ways, many of those ways seen, but also many ways unseen. So today is our time to really see you and really honor this work and service that you give to this community. Congregation, I'm going to also ask you to formally accept these three in these roles in a minute. We'll have some words to say. You'll know your part. I'll ask you to say we do, and you can say we do if you do. But let's begin with you three. I'm going to ask you for a commitment into this role. So Millie Fuller, Ed Cosper, and Mark Cobb. By this act of installation, do you officially commit yourselves for the next 2 years to serve as ministry associates for Emerson Unitarian Universalist Congregation? Do you freely accept the responsibilities, challenges, and joys inherent in this role? And do you promise to be open and available to your fellow congregants with the intention to create love, compassion, and justice in our work together? If you do, please say, I do.
I do.
I heard them all. Did you hear them all? Yes. All right. And now I'm going to invite the members of Emerson Unitarian Universalist Congregation. Anybody who thinks that maybe someday you would like to be a member of Emerson Unitarian Universalist Congregation, I'll invite you to stand so that we can face these three together. In recognition of these individuals' leadership, experience, education, and commitment to our Unitarian Universalist principles and to Emerson's mission and vision, I have a question for you. Will you support them in their work? Will you speak the truth in love when they most need to hear it? And will you encourage their ongoing development as servers and leaders in this congregation? If so, please say, we do.
We do. Awesome.
So that you may remember this commitment and that others may help remind you of your commitment, I would like to ask you to exchange your current name tags for some new ones. They are quite bright in color, so you will not miss who they are. They didn't have a vote in this color, so I told them we can change it later if they need to. But for right now, they are rainbow. Oops. Can you get that? Oh, maybe you need... Oh, you know what? You're gonna need this. You need the magnet part. Millie, do you have yours? Oh, you have it. This is, I need a magnet for you. Ooh. Yeah. Ed and Millie and Mark. May you remember that there is no such thing as perfect in our love and service of others, for surely we will fail. But what makes you leaders here in this place is your steadfast commitment to find all the barriers to love and to work to remove them. Thank you for your service and for your love to Emerson and your support of me in this role. I couldn't do it without you. So thank you. Let's welcome our new ministry associates officially here. We'll give you each a hug. Thank you. Go. Come back for hugs. Thank you. Now, the thing that, Millie, I owe you a hug. I just want to make a statement here. I was realizing at the order of service that we put this in, and then we have this song, which is about laying your burdens down. Those two aren't connected. You guys can't do that. Take it away, Kathy.
Oh.
Stephanie, that was awesome. I mean, all of you, that was awesome. That was really, really awesome. Diane Hilbisch, the meanest girl in the entire kindergarten. She would take your scissors, make rude comments about your pictures. She'd butt in and answer all the teacher's questions and claim she was the teacher's pet. And then, at recess, little Diane would walk around the playground as if she was all that. And she would be deciding who could or could not play Foursquare that day. Every time I saw her, it made me angry. Who did she think she was? Now, somehow the teacher sensed our discomfort with each other and pulled us aside one day, declaring that we should be friends, forgive our disagreements, and shake hands. Forgive her for all her wrongdoings? Let her off the hook? No way, wasn't gonna happen in a million years. No way, I don't wanna, and you can't make me. Okay, so, who's your Diane Hilbisch? I know you have one, or two, three. Whether it was in kindergarten decades ago, or at work last year, or a relationship last week, I'm pretty confident we have all had that experience. Someone has done us wrong, or been a total jerk. Am I allowed to say jerk from the pulpit? Okay. Been a total jerk, or at least that is how we see it. And someone else, possibly even our own conscience, tells them that we need to offer them grace, compassion, forgiveness, and dare I say, loving kindness. We must assume good intentions, we are advised, even if we are sure that it sure looks like their intentions were anything but good. Now, I know many times we do that, right? We shift. We see the bigger picture, we feel compassion for their life and open our hearts. We see our own part in a relationship debacle and come to a good place of openness and acceptance. We do good. But sometimes it's trickier, isn't it? Sometimes instead, deep inside, we scream, no way. I will not let them off the hook for what they've done. I'm not offering them love. I don't want to, and you can't make me. I recently saw a sign that said, if thought bubbles appeared above my head, I'd be in trouble. I'm assuming you agree. Ooh, but what if I can read thought bubbles? Yeah, I'm sure we've all had those moments when we're glad that thought bubbles don't instantaneously appear above our heads, right? Can you imagine? Because we really do fashion ourselves as kind and loving people. But then again, is it true that our principles actually mean that everyone has inherent worth and dignity and should be treated with compassion and love? I mean, isn't there an asterisk there? I mean, yes, we are all interconnected, but how many of us have had that thought bubble that says, not connected to that guy over there carrying that flag, totally not connected to that one wearing that hat, not much worth in that one doing those things over there. For those people, I've decided I'm going to just go ahead and keep my feelings of anger and resentment and judgment, open my heart and offer them compassion and love. No way, I don't want to, and you can't make me. I get it. And that is the sermon for today. It is over. I mean, I can't make you, right? I can't threaten hell and damnation to get you to do something, so I got nothing. Okay, I have a few things. I have just a few things. Now, I want to tell you that when Kathy and I had first picked this song, Lay Your Burdens Down, for the service months ago, the service was actually some other service about something totally different. So when I shifted the topic and decided I wanted to talk about loving kindness, Kathy rightly wondered, you know, if the anthem should also be shifted and asked me what I'd like to do. So one day I sat down and I listened to like all kinds of versions of this powerful African-American spiritual over and over. Glory, glory, hallelujah, since I laid my burdens down. Did you hear the words? All my sickness will be over. Feeling so much better since I laid my burdens down. And there's many variations on this song. Some of them include these words. Friends don't treat me like they used to since I laid my burdens down. And I won't treat you like I used to since I laid my burdens down. Now, I know one interpretation of this song implies that once I'm dead, I lay down the burdens of this life and get to go up to heaven where those burdens don't exist. Hallelujah, right? But given that we're Unitarian Universalists here and not all convinced about this heaven thing, there's another interpretation that is kind of perfect for our topic today, which is why I said, let's keep that song. After all, isn't the greatest burdens in this life, the life we're living right now, the ones that make us sick, that make us feel bad, the burdens that make us treat people unkindly, are not the earthly body burdens and hardships it endures, but our greatest burdens are our emotional burdens, the ones the emotional body carries and insists on carrying. Perhaps our greatest burdens are the fact that the opinions, judgments, anger, hatred, condemnation, and fears that we hold toward each other's are really impacting us. And that includes those judgments, angers, hatreds, condemnations that we hold towards ourselves as well. Imagine for a moment what it would feel like if inside of you, you were freed from carrying any of that, all of that, right? I think it would be time to sing hallelujah, letting go of all that. But I know it's easier said than done, but I think it's worth attempting. I'm going to try a little bit of that today in our service. I also want to say that if you're a Unitarian Universalist, I kind of think it's a requirement of our faith to at least try to lay down those burdens. And luckily, we have some good resources. This is where I want to bring up a little bit about this Jewish tradition that is beginning this evening, this idea of these high holy days. They know well, the Jewish people knew well, that we need help laying down our burdens. So they've designated a whole time of the year, each year, for the work of repentance. It's a time to lay down the burdens of our own wrongdoings and the burdens that we hold against others. As I mentioned earlier today, tonight actually begins Rosh Hashanah. So this is the new year. This is the beginning of the new year. Happy, what number is it?
5,783.
You got it. So happy 5,783, everybody. Following Rosh Hashanah, though, there are these 10 days of awe. And these are all about repentance. And for these 10 days, the Jewish people are directed to reflect on the previous year and what they may have done, what injuries they have made on other people, and they're asked to try to make things right with those people that they may have harmed. And it's also a time to practice forgiveness when we have felt harmed from others. Rosh Hashanah is sometimes referred to as the time of creation, as it is when one can recreate themselves through the acts of reflection and forgiveness and getting right with God. I like to say, getting right with my own heart. Now, I'm not Jewish, but I've often wished that this religious holiday was as baked into our secular society as Christmas and Easter have become. I'm pretty confident it's because of a culture of anti-Semitism, but also because Hallmark and corporations haven't figured out how to market this holiday for profit in the same way that they have with Santa and the Easter Bunny, right? Can you imagine these ads? Want to have true forgiveness? Make sure to buy your enemies lots of stuff. Wait for it. Because these are the days of always shopping. No? All right. Anyway. But maybe the real reason that it's not become a secular holiday is, well, self-reflection and owning what we've done and asking for forgiveness and offering forgiveness isn't always much fun, right? But of course, the Jews are not alone in recognizing the healing power of compassion and forgiveness. The Dalai Lama has spoken about a Buddhist practice whereby one is to visualize an enemy as having been a loving mother in another life. The idea is that all sentient beings have lived before, and therefore we cannot really know the relationship we may have to each other. So look around for a minute. You may be sitting beside your mother. I know some of you are sitting beside your mother in this lifetime, but otherwise, right? If we assume that at least in one lifetime, the person across from us with whom we may be having a difficult time was once a loving parent or a loving partner or friend, someone that truly cared about us and that whom we truly cared about, the idea is that it would be easier to forgive them or we'd be more apt to come into unison with them when we have conflict. Now, I have to admit, while this sounds like a nice theory, that I have a hard time picturing an AR-15 carrying, swastika wearing, white supremacist as a gentle, caring mother to me, making me chicken pot pie, but I'm open to the possibility. And I get the idea, right? It does bring up this sense of, oh, what would it be like to treat each other as if we actually loved each other? Fred Luskin, professor and director of the Stanford University Forgiveness Project and author of a book called Forgive for Good, says forgiveness, and by this, forgiving self and others, is ultimately about the ability to be at peace inside ourselves right now. Luskin points out that we are the ones who create any lack of peace we are experiencing, and so we are the only ones that can remedy the situation. He describes it in very Buddhist-like terms by saying, life happens, life arises. But then what happens is, life happens and we object to it, right? Your Honor, I have an objection. Don't like that thing that just happened. In objecting to our own life, he adds, we are saying, no, that should not have happened. That part of my life, that part of me is wrong. And it is that objection that causes us this emotional, spiritual, physical pain. And I love the statement he makes about it. He says, forgiveness is our resolution of the objection. Did you get that? Forgiveness is our way to resolve this objection that we had to life. In making peace when we don't get what we want, we are released from the turmoil we create. In Buddhism, this practice of letting go, of forgiveness, and of seeing the other as not responsible for our life, of releasing the other from our judgments and resentments and frustrations, it takes the form of a practice called metta. Now, metta is actually a practice, and the word is found in even pre-Buddhist texts, in the Vedic Sanskrit texts, as Maitri or Amitra. It's derived from a word that does mean love. And these Vedic words started appearing back in the Rig Vedas, which are 1500 BCE, so thousands and thousands of years ago. In Pali, the word metta is translated to mean loving kindness, so we come up with this modern day idea of metta, loving kindness. It's very integral to the Theravadin school of Buddhism. In the Buddhist text, we find the Metta Sutra. So I'm going to read it to you in a minute. So this is an ancient sutra written about this concept of how we are to treat others. I love to keep in mind that this was written a whole long time ago, Because I always find that when I study texts of ancient texts, like how similar their lives are to ours. Even though there's so many differences, we still seem to struggle with the same things. So here's what this sutra says. It says, and you'll recognize some of these words. May all beings be happy and secure. May they be happy-minded. Whatever living beings there are, feeble or strong, long, stout or medium, short, small or large, seen or unseen, those dwelling far or near, those who are born or those who await rebirth, may all beings, without exception, be happy-minded. Let none deceive another, nor despise any person, whatever, in any place. In anger or ill will, let them not wish any suffering on each other. Just as a mother would protect her only child at the risk of her own life, even so, let him cultivate a boundless heart towards all beings. Let her thoughts of boundless loving kindness pervade the whole world, above, below, and across, without obstruction, without any hatred, without any discord. It seems very relevant as a prayer for today as well, right? It's not like they did that and then we all got it and now we live in this society of perfect loving kindness. Somehow we need reminded again and again. There's a Buddhist parable about a monk and a scorpion. One day this monk was walking along the river and he saw this scorpion struggling in the river. So he knelt down and put his hand out to get the scorpion out. And of course, as he was lifting it out, the scorpion stung him and he dropped back into the water. So the monk tried again. He put his hand underneath and tried to lift up the scorpion, and again the scorpion stung him. And this was repeated several times. And there was a little boy who was playing near the stream, and he watched the scene repeat again and again, and he said, "Excuse me, why do you keep trying to save the scorpion? Don't you know it will just sting you every time you try to rescue it?" And the monk, picking up a leaf this time to rescue the scorpion, successfully replied, "Oh, dear boy, just as the scorpion's nature is to sting and the water's nature is to make things wet, it is my nature, a monk, to save." Over this past month, we have explored this theme of service and invited you in various ways to ask, what is your nature? Right? How shall you live? And today we take the wisdom of the Jewish tradition of atonement, modern psychological research on forgiveness, and Buddhist philosophy of metta and ask, how now will you love? What barriers must you let down in yourself so that you are able to offer to all beings everywhere a prayer of loving kindness and really mean it when you do? Buddhist teacher Sharon Salzberg has said, "Metta, the practice of metta meditation, is the ability to embrace all parts of ourselves, as well as all parts of the world. Practicing metta illuminates our inner integrity because it relieves us of the need to deny different aspects of ourselves." So very similar to what the psychologist was talking about. So we're here today, and what a better time than now to practice. So because we did not get a chance to do some reflection earlier, I'm going to invite us into a brief practice of metta meditation. So if you'd like to, you can find a place that's comfortable. I invite you to close your eyes if that feels comfortable for you. So I'm going to lead you, and you're going to recognize some of the words, but we're going to do several parts to the metta meditation. And it's always important when we start metta meditation to start with the self. So I'm going to invite you to take a few breaths and just come into your own body right now in your own space. Turning your awareness towards yourself, if you feel drawn to, feel free to even use your hands to touch your own heart, directing this energy towards you. I'm going to ask you to repeat these words after me, and you can do this in silence if you want or out loud. Either one's fine. But holding your own heart, offer this to yourself. May I be filled with loving kindness. May I be free from harm and suffering. May I be well in body, heart, and mind. May I be at peace. Let yourself really feel the offering of that prayer to yourself, offering your own body, mind, and spirit a prayer of loving kindness. May you be well. And now I'm going to invite you to turn your awareness to someone for whom you love. So someone in your life that is easy to love, that brings joy to your heart in just thinking about them. Imagine them in your mind's eye right now. See if you can picture them. And looking at them eye to eye, say these words to them. May you be filled with loving kindness. May you be free from harm and suffering. May you be well in body, heart, and mind. May you be at peace. Again, imagine this person with whom you love being drenched in this prayer of well-being and loving kindness. Then I invite you to turn your awareness to someone in your life, perhaps that you don't know too well, maybe someone in the congregation you are just getting to know, maybe someone you pass by on your morning walks, someone that you just know a little bit. So a casual stranger. Go ahead and pick that person and then visualize them in your mind's eye. Make it a very specific person. And offer them these words. May you be filled with loving kindness. May you be free from harm and suffering. May you be well in body, heart, and mind. May you be at peace. And visualize their face taking in this prayer of loving kindness. And now it's time to turn this loving kindness towards someone whom you have had some conflict. And you don't have to pick the hardest person in your life. It can just be somebody with whom you're ready or close to ready to offer this prayer to. So go ahead and imagine that person in your mind's eye, somebody that maybe there's been some frustration with or anger. If you can't think of anybody, go to that first person who popped into your head. And holding them, looking at them in your mind's eye, say these words to them. May you be filled with loving kindness. May you be free from harm and suffering. May you be well in body, heart, and mind. And may you be at peace. Looking at them, perhaps bowing your head to them, this great teacher of yours, offering them a prayer of loving kindness. And finally, in your mind's eye, see if you can visualize a whole group of people. Perhaps you want to visualize a group of people that you do not know their specific names, but
a group that you might have had hard feelings towards, discord, disagreement. So looking towards this generalized group of people, recognizing that those feelings exist in you. See if you can shift them as you offer them this prayer. May you be filled with loving kindness. May you be free from harm and suffering. May you be well in body, heart, and mind. And may you be at peace. I'm going to invite you to stay in your seats as we sing our closing hymn. The words are up here. It's very simple. It's the hymn of loving kindness. And we will do I, and then you, and then we to end. Think that that is the way for us to save the world. And I'm not saying we shouldn't go out there and protest and do all the other justice work that we do. But I do truly believe if we all practice this metta meditation over and over in our lives, that we will make a difference in the world. The Dalai Lama has said, love and compassion are necessities, not luxuries. Without them, humanity cannot survive. Oh, by the way, Diane Hilbisch and I became best friends in first grade, and we stayed best friends for many, many, many years afterwards. We didn't have metta meditation back then, but something about being a child and their open hearts must have just shifted us. So, to you, Diane. May you go forth this week and practice this, really practice our faith of Unitarian Universalism in every chance that you get. I have a few announcements as we shift. On your order of service, we are today, the service committee that we are highlighting is our media team. So if you have any skills in these areas listed, if you look at your little like pull-out thing. We're looking for people that can take pictures, create videos, work on our website, maybe create some social media posts. Don't have to do all those things, but any of those things. If that's you and you would like to contribute in that way, you can either fill this out and drop it with Judy or one of the greeters on your way out, or come see me. I'll be at a table in the fellowship hall. So we will do that. And on that note, I have a little sad note, which has a happiness to it too, but the sad part is our beloved Maggie Baker will be departing us. She has, as many of you probably know, she lives like way down south in Dixie, down in Griffin, and she has taken a new position that's a full-time position that is closer to her home, so she will not be able to be with us. She's going to have 1 week transition, so this Sunday and next Sunday are your only two times to say thank you and send her off with your well wishes, so feel free to find her to do that. And the happy part is that we will be welcoming Sarah Drew as our new office administrator. Some of you recognize Sarah Drew was our intern last year, our ministerial intern, so she'll take a couple weeks to get up and running, but she will be, the office will, should be proceeding without too many bumps. So welcome Sarah if you would. I don't see a Sarah in the room. I think she's back in the fellowship hall. So welcome her when you see her. I think that's all I have to say. Ed, you want to take us out? And Adrian, do you want to, oh, yep, there you are. You're ready. Is it like 11:30 or something? It feels late. Okay.
Maggie, you'll be missed. Deborah, wow, that was an amen sermon. Okay, that was good. I'd just like to share with you something about this loving kindness that happened this week, and I've been touched by what happened all week long, and I just want to share it with you. On Wednesday night, at our choir rehearsal, we did something so special. We reached out by phone to Fred and Marjorie Maisie. Many of you know who those folks are. And we sang the anthem that we sang today to Fred and Marjorie Maisie. And I just want to say thank you to our choir for doing such a wonderful, kind act of kindness. That was fantastic. That was just fantastic. Fantastic. We hope you have been nourished in heart and mind by our worship today. If you would like more information about Unitarian Universalism or about participation here at Emerson, please stop by our welcome table in the front entry. We've got folks out there this morning ready to meet you and greet you and tell you stuff about us. Please plan to join us next week as Reverend Deborah offers a message titled Faulty Programming. Ooh, a little different than this week. As our chalice is extinguished this morning, please join Adrian Tice in the final words. They are posted in the chat and in the order of service. Adrian.
We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts and out into the world until we are together again.
Please join us for refreshments and fellowship in our fellowship room on the first floor near the back doors. Those of you online, please stay tuned in and you'll be able to go to virtual breakout rooms for fellowship time. At 11:15, we offer religious education and exploration for children, youth, and adults. Please see in your order of service the times and locations. For adults or youth or whomever, if you'd like to join me in the sanctuary for worship reflections at 11:15. And Ginger White will be in room 103 with Uncomfortable Conversations. All right, Ginger. All right. Okay. See your order of service for other offerings throughout the week, and also make sure that know that you can go to the calendar and to the website to see all kinds of activities and offerings here at Emerson. Our service is now concluded, but our connection has only begun.
Go now in peace and take peace wherever you go.